Okay, hi everybody. I would like to take a moment just to thank the young people and you ladies and gentlemen for inviting me to be here today. I represent the Children's Rights Bureau, which is a small NGO that provides children with social and legal support on the streets, very much on the street level in Stockholm. So I'm particularly pleased that I'm here as a grassroots actor that work every day hands-on with children and children's rights. And I'm particularly pleased that I'm here as a representative of the young people that we meet. And it's their stories and their experiences and the challenges that they face that I will try to talk to you about today. So I have named my little, now 7-minute talk, The Never-Ending Flight, and I would like to highlight the issues, what happens when children are fleeing war. They go from their country of origin to transfer countries to the country of destination, and what happens when you take the destination out of the journey. So this is just a little bit short about the organization that I come from. We're very newly founded last year, but we've been providing our services to children, all children, under the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and we work with all rights. But since our start in 2011, we have worked with a lot of children that are facing difficulties and challenges by their immigration status or migration history. So we work mainly hands-on with kids and providing them with legal and social support, but also do structural advocacy work, and that's why I'm here today. But all our structural advocacy work and everything I'll talk about today is based on the experiences of the children that we meet. What we are seeing in Sweden right now is a new paradigm. I've been working in this field for the last 12 years, and more has happened over the last year for children and migration than over the last 30 years, I would say. In the summer 2016, a new laws and practices were put in place as a response to the immigration or the refugee crisis that we saw last autumn. These new laws and practices the main rule of these new laws and practices are much more restrictive. That means we are not seeing permanent permits for children, and we are seeing much more restrictive practices when it comes to family reunification and other burning issues for the children who seek protection in Sweden. We are seeing much more restrictive practices when it comes to basic care and protection of children and also young people. Children with rejected application on their 18th birthday are no longer have rights to basic protection such as food money, food vouchers, or a roof over their head. This might be as familiar practices or familiar situations for many countries in crisis, but in Sweden we've had over the years built up a system where we've tried to protect children and be the new home country that they have seek protection in. So what we have seen as this small NGO in Stockholm over the last few years, but mainly over the last year, is an increasing number of children with rejected applications. And this is a hugely difficult process, of course, primarily for the child. The child has gone through a difficult journey, risked their lives, left their families, trauma behind them, everything. And they come to Sweden and they go through this long wait, as Fredrik was talking about, suffer mental health issues, and go through a real difficult time in their life. And they end up with a rejected application. So the hope for the new life is taken away. We can also see that this is really difficult work for all involved parties, not just the children, but also the professionals, the social workers, the teachers, the legal advisors, everyone around them are really struggling with this, with the piece of work that they need to do. And this is a rapidly growing group. A few years ago, or just 2-3 years ago, we were talking about 100 children in the hundreds that was facing this situation. But with, like Fredrik was saying, 35,000 unaccompanied minors seeking protection in Sweden just in last year, we fear that almost half of them, 10,000-15,000, will not be given permanent protection in Sweden, which means they will be continue to be on the run. They will continue to be unprotected, either as children or as young people. And what we can see as well is that very, very few actually return. The idea that you have a rejected application, you will go back to your home country to a reception or a return procedure where your rights are protected, we don't see that. There are massive inadequate parts of the return process. So what we see instead is that these children and young people, they stay on our streets. And some, we see as well, are in a legal vacuum. We have recently released a report on the situation of North African young people, children and young people who come to Europe where they are not granted asylum or protection, but their home country won't receive them back, so they end up on our streets. So I would like to leave you with the question of what happens to fleeing children when there is no longer a safe destination? What happens to children when the new homeland offers no hope? Sweden can be proud of the reception system that we have built up over the last 10 years of education, health, social, housing, all those parts. We are sadly now seeing the system being dismantled. And what will happen to the thousands of young people and children seeking protection where they have seen Northern Europe and Sweden as their end destination, when they no longer will be offered the protection that they have been seeking? We know from the young people that we meet that they won't disappear. They might disappear from the systems, which most of them will do, but they won't disappear from the face of the earth. They will be here, they will be around us, but they will be largely unprotected. And that's something that is concerning us a lot. And I will also end with a quote. I'm afraid that is not as hopeful as Fredrik's, but it comes from one of our young people, Abdul, who's 17 years old, who's told us that going back is worse than a life on the streets here, and I will never go back. And this is a reality that Sweden and Europe really need to take into consideration over the coming years. Thank you.